A műsor támogatói: az On The Spot technikai partnere, a 220 volt webáruház.
About 50 years ahead of time, therefore I am not thinking of today or day after tomorrow, but I'm thinking some 50 years or 100 years ahead.
Idi Amin diktatúrája 1971-ben kezdődött, alig 10 évvel azután, hogy Uganda kivívta függetlenségét az angoloktól. Amin korábban a brit hadseregben magasabb szintre emelkedett, mint addig bármelyik fekete katona. Később diktátorként egyszerre hivatta magát Uganda elnökének, marsalnak, díszdoktornak, a brit birodalom meghódítójának és Skócia koronázatlan királyának.
Az Amin rezsim idején legalább 300 ezer embert öltek meg. Idi Amin paranoiája odáig jutott, hogy megölette az ugandai érseket és két miniszterét is, akik közül az egyik, Obot Ofumbi, a diktátor legfőbb bizalmasa és jó barátja is volt. Amin összeesküvést és árulást sejtett. A keresztény többségű Uganda muzulmán diktátora először Kaddafihoz menekült Líbiába, majd Szaúd-Arábiában telepedett le. Több mint 60 gyereke volt. Jafar különösen közel állt hozzá. Az apja halála után néhány évvel ezelőtt visszatért Ugandába.
Amin és Godfrey Ofumbi, a meggyilkolt miniszter fia, gyerekkorukból ismerik egymást. Jafar Szaúd-Arábiában, Godfrey az Egyesült Államokban élt, és csak egy évvel ezelőtt találkoztak újra Ugandában. Most ugyanannak az üzletembernek dolgoznak, és épp a Kidepo Nemzeti Park felé tartanak, hogy felmérjenek egy szállodát, amit annak idején még Idi Amin kezdett el építeni, de még mielőtt befejezhette volna, megbukott. Hosszú és nehéz út vár rájuk. Ugandában senki sem érti, hogy mit keres egymás mellett ez a két férfi, hiszen Godfrey apjának gyilkosa Idi Amin volt.
Land Cruiser.
Well done. I was so scared last night. Let me tell you the truth. I was scared that we would fail to get here. It's not a question of the environment. It's just, I'm going to disappoint my friends. We've got to be there. You're visualizing the savannah, which we were looking at now.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Especially when we got stuck.
That's
know,
it!
I said, oh no, what is it? So close yet so far, you know, so to speak.
I remember Jet Fighter, that nickname was your dad who came up with it.
Well, yo, remind me of that.
He said, oh, yeah. When they came over to see us, everyone had gone shopping. So I was the only one in the house, and I was upstairs. And I remember my dad calling me and saying, hey, Godfrey, come down, your hero's there. That's the first time I ever met your dad. So
This is what, 73?
No, 60. Whoa. Before, he was still army commander.
Okay.
So came down to, I remember distinctly, he was in a plain mottled green army uniform. Yeah, this is my youngest son, and he wants to be a pilot, and he likes soldiers, you're his hero. But your dad looked and said, oh, wow, he wants to be a pilot. Okay, we'll send him to Russia to be a fighter pilot. Then he said, okay, like, your jet fighter.
My dad's expression was this, huh?
Yeah. Huh.
When he's brushing off something, it's always, if it's an accusation, hii ni parapaganda yao. Para, not propaganda. Para.
Yeah, para, yeah, well, the accent thing.
Warthogs! Yeah. Oh my God!
Are they there?
That's the water buck.
Let's see.
Oh my God, look at the goodness here.
You just have to look at the...
Give me a look. Yeah, like that. I've got a perfect frontal. Give me another one.
Goodness, look at the weight of that. That's a ton.
But there's somebody who called it... Idia means monstrosity. Amonye! It just means thank you very much. Amonye, Dad, thank you very much. Goody? Is that something or what?
Yeah, it is.
Isa,
yes, my brother.
Where is the visitor's book? This is the reception.
Yeah, this is the reception, actually.
The manager's office. Huh? I can't believe that.
The mix is
different. My father loved hunting, and this place meant a lot to him. And every time he disappeared, he was either in Para or here. And the fact that one of the people who I considered an uncle, called Cordette, took up the challenge of trying to be an indigenous investor in such a setup brings a lot of hope to me, because it was my dream and aspiration. This is a unique monument to at least the positive legacy of my father, so that's why it has become an obsession with me. This is the last frontier. This is the ultimate beautiful place for me. This is heaven on earth. Honestly, it touches me at the same level I think it touched him.
Really solid, eh?
Well, basically, we're here as an advisory. I think we could change and turn this place around. Help our uncle out, Mr. Cadet. That's the main, basically. That's how I think we could do it. That's how I see it. Work it out like that. It's not going to be easy, but I do see the light at the end of the tunnel. I'd want to retire here. I'd want to bring my 6 children here. Every quality time I'd want to share it with them here. What did your father say about my dad, if you talked about it any time afterwards in those days, if you ever asked him? I'd really want to know that. What was his reminiscence, or what happened, or so? What did he say?
Let me put it into perspective.
Yeah.
Your father was a fulcrum. He was the administrative arm of what made Dad function. He was the functioning nut in an engine.
Yeah, all the weapons.
He was the man that made Dad look
normal. I'm not saying my father was abnormal. I'm just saying he made, if you have a secretary or you have a spokesperson, the person in America who they would call the man who makes me look good.
Yeah.
He was basically what they proverbially call the power behind the throne. There are a lot of those who come and talk their nonsense,
you know,
about being the power. Listen, listen to this point. Listen to this point.
I've heard that.
Listen to this point.
I've seen so
listen
many.
To this point. Listen
no,
to this
no,
point.
No,
huh?
But I just want to just back you up on that. Yeah. I've seen so many other people who are still alive now who claim
there.
To have been the power behind the throne,
dad.
But they're not.
Now,
I know it.
Now,
we know the truth.
Let's go get back to this one.
Okay.
Your father was the technocrat, the real person behind everything, but there were others who were the equivalent of what I call Iagos, who were always on the side. It's like, why him? For them, they were thinking on an ethnic level.
I know.
Guy is from the East. Yeah, yeah. We are your uncles. Why are you giving all the responsibility to him? Your father held the strings of all the procurements. It was a military government. Yours had always been there since the British. Your father was the point man, the man responsible for everything. You get him, you get Amin. Huh? The best thing I can do in a car is take out your battery and see what you'll do.
Right, and former President Moi told me, so that, you know, when we dealt with Uganda, we only dealt with your dad. Because
Thank
we kind of
much.
Looked at him
the
as being
man.
The point man and everything.
Yeah, always.
That's why after the tragedy, they looked after us.
When the incident came of the issue of the accusation of insurrection, it was so easy to accuse your father or implicate him in Orema's
and the Archbishop.
Ambition. Leave alone the Archbishop. The Archbishop was a bridge. If you want to get to the community, go through the religious leaders. You come and put these people in the hands of the instigator. Now, take them away until the tribunal starts. Your father is being put in the hands of the person who feels you're not deserving of your position. Now, the several people who were at that instant, was saying, no, we're not going to go through a tribunal. This is not a tribunal issue. Didn't he ask the whole crowd, the mob, what do I do with these people? The scream was what?
Kill them now.
Wow.
Yeah,
wow.
Yeah, yeah. In Swahili.
Kill them. Kill them. Now, that, for me, explains what is considered anarchy. Anarchy is, you're in absolute power, but you have lieutenants who feel they have the right to do whatever they want.
With your blessing?
No. Not so much of a blessing. Anarchy is when everybody feels they can do whatever they want. I never take away the responsibility, the political responsibility of the deaths of Luwum or Riema and your dad from my father. I don't take it away at a political level. If you're in absolute power, death under your watch becomes
your responsibility.
With your dad, it was the issue of having jumped the gun. You know, actions on the spur of the moment, which was a very bad negative side of dad. Spur of the moment decisions without evaluating. That is where the pain would come into him. It's like, if I had sat back and counted to six and made a decision, if I were, you see, it becomes a lamentation.
Yeah, it's, yeah, there could be a basis to truth in it. The president was misguided. And instead of him sitting down and saying, wait a minute, let's evaluate and let's investigate, carry on a thorough investigation, he reacted tragically.
How many people died in the Amin era?
I don't know that number. But there's a researcher whose father died a similar manner like your father, called Fred Guedeko. He always states, people say and judge Uganda's killings as between 100,000 and
100,000. But through his research, including the death of his father, including two wars, 72 and 79, beginning at 78, there's a count of 10,600 deaths.
I've heard numbers being told from 300,000 up to 1 million. That's what I've over the years been come across in my own, not research, but readings.
It's easy to quote 300 to 1 million, but you should always be able to say which mouthpiece announced the numbers, who quoted what. You get to a point of asking the names, put names to the figures. It doesn't come out. It ends at 10,600 plus.
Then my father said, I want to resign and join the United Nations. He said that on several occasions. And there's one time that I remember distinctively, that was a month before the tragedy. We're in Kampala House. It was in the evening. Hans Ziegler, Z-Mix Aviation, comes over. Driving, he was flying off that day. And he was talking. Then my father called us out. He said, something is going to happen. I feel it, because I know there's something not right. But should anything happen to me and I'm killed, Mr. Ziegler, take care of my family. Please do. And then Hans Ziegler, being his cavalier self, was saying, you know, I remember he turned around and then he said, hey, you young guys, don't worry, nothing's going to happen to your dad. No one smiled. Everyone just had that stone face. My dad just looked at him. My brother Sam and Michael and I, we just looked at him. Then he realized, that was a bad joke. This is serious here. I'll never forget that. It was around 6 o'clock in the evening. Then he left. Then my dad said, okay, you guys. And then about 2 weeks later, drove us to the airport. And I remember climbing into the plane. And as I was going in the steps, I remember turning around and looking at him as he was walking with the bodyguards back, then he went out of view. That was the last time I ever saw him. A month later, he was dead. And the day that he died, my mom calls the Kampala House to talk to Uncle Musomoka and say, oh, how's everything going on? He says, you know, your husband, my dad, has been arrested. We don't know what's going on. Things are really bad. You know, that's the expression in Uganda. Those days. Things are bad. That's what my dad always used to say. Things are bad. Things are bad. He said, oh. So I've never seen my mom just break down like that. She just sat down, just started shaking. And then Sergeant of BI didn't know what to do. And John, the other bodyguards, they didn't know what to do. They said, now what do we do here? They started shaking. Then my mom immediately said, you know what? Let me take off. Let me drive back to Uganda. We tried to tell her, no, don't go. Don't go. She said, no, let me go. My brother Mike was on the table. We were all sitting and having lunch. Mama just left a couple of hours earlier. And Mike always liked listen to BBC, you know, because we're all worried with something had gone wrong. And then I remember Mike saying, I said, what? Dad is dead. That's basically the day, how I remember the day went. It was horrific. And
I guess it's like you made a statement about it's maybe being childish, but wishing you could go back in time. And change things. Mm. And then
let me give you the day.
Yeah, just wait.
I'm giving you the day also.
Yeah. But I remember saying to myself, even a week later, a month later, 2 months later, I was saying to myself, it's not too late yet. If I could only get back home, we dig up Dad's body, they can still bring him back to life. They can still bring him back to that. And that was a month, 6 months later. After a year went, then I said to myself, no, it's been 1 year now. It's too late now to bring him back to life.
Can we really stay together? Can we go the extra mile together? But the spiritual journey to Tororo is unraveling the confidence that I've always had all my life. My throat is dry. I don't know what it means.
Give me a profile. Oh, you're a poser. No, no, it's a child. They're young. They're all babies. Oh, give us a stretch. Give us a stretch. Yeah, that's it.
If we come to this house and pay respects to Mother, God will say, open the doors. Not for power, but to live peacefully.
We had a tortoise crossing, and then
chicken, white chicken crossing in Lira, then in Gulu, Kumi,
yes.
And then the Kulu Kulu white one just near here.
Yeah.
That's when I said, I'm coming in peace.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Why am I
coming?
Our mom. Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah. So we're the only two children around in Uganda. Yeah. Me
the rest
and,
are in England, America.
Well, in Kenya, Switzerland, America. That's where everyone is, yeah.
Dad's car.
Yeah.
You used to drive with him?
There were many of them, but this is the only one that's still around, still remaining. I remember when the car came in 1971, brand new! Well, I still remember the popping the champagne, choo-choo! Here from Germany, it was lovely.
So this historical.
That was mainly for the cattle. And the chicken line, the poultry line, because of the cows over here and so on.
So it was
completely, fully mechanized. Transfer tubes, the whole thing, the works. There used to be four
silos outside. The foundations are still there, so someone can see that, hey, this once was.
Yeah.
It's here.
It is, but it's very inspiring, honestly. Yeah. And I'm grateful to be here.
Oh, thank you. My dad built this building here, my brother Sam, Michael and I, yeah. And so it was meant to be our place. We didn't really stay here, we all wanted to stay over there. So. Four bedroom. Now here's the helicopter landing. Huh?
That's where you'd meet Dad here.
Exactly.
And Dad would come and land here.
And then there was a time the second time when he came in, two helicopters came and they landed here. And one of them didn't start. Okay. I don't know what happened with it, but they kept on trying to start
the
it.
The gyro.
The rotors kept turning and turning and turning. It just wouldn't light up.
This batch.
Yeah. I told you.
And we scan
them. You see, look at it. Here's my chrome dome. That's my brother Mike here. Everyone's here.
Wow.
There he is.
This was when it landed.
Hey, wait a minute.
This is iconic. This picture. Hmm. This picture shows togetherness more than anything I've ever. Look at the look.
Right. Okay.
Now this is your elder sister, but she looks exactly.
Let me tell you. This. Is my cousin, late cousin Mary.
That's little Julie. She's in England now. That's Esther.
Okay.
My sister Esther.
She's here.
Excuse me.
Where's the one with Han? There you go. You.
There I am, picking my nose. I always just do that.
No.
Okay. I guess this is how it actually looked. And that's a me. And his wife.
God, Amin was a huge man.
Yeah, he was tall.
And who's that little girl?
That's the daughter.
Amin's daughter?
Amin's daughter.
Look at your mom. She's so pretty.
When you lose a head of a family, so many things change. And even if you have the toughest of a mother or a wife, life definitely changes for the children. Very difficult time, you know, instance where you have no money, no school fees, so many resources, basic resources, basic needs, you can't meet basic needs and such issues. It's not been a very nice time.
Margaret. Yes. Oh, he come here.
That's my eldest son. Hi, my name is Matthew, and this is.
That's the Dakota for you.
Yeah, exactly.
Then the small wheel at the back.
Yeah, the back. And so swivels.
You know, very tired children in the helicopter.
I know.
Then it goes to Kampala, lands at where Serena is, picks Mama Sarah. Then we're off again with Captain Sematimba heading for Jinja.
Now, can you imagine us children actually insisting, Dad, we are tired of helicopters, we want to go by road. Then they started taking us out by road. That to me I found strange. On hindsight, that he was loving enough to put a security detail around us to satisfy our needs.
We went to school in Kenya all our lives at that time.
But also by helicopter?
Yeah, a couple of times. And then the other times was mainly by a convoy of vehicles from Kampala. That UVL was amongst one of them. It was just brand spanking new then, so everyone would come with the envy of, you know, my fellow students. They'll say, oh, wow, what a Merc. I say, yeah, you feel, in those days, it was all British thing, chuffed. And that's how we used to say it. So, you know, it was good. It was fun, though. We, it's good memories.
Nostalgia. Yes.
No, yes. Very nostalgic.
Very, yeah. Honestly, you are your father's son. That's the only way I can say it.
Yeah.
And everybody will always come and compare you at that. You're never called Jafar. They always say son of Idi Amin.
Idi Amin. That's true.
And you're judged for any negativity or positivity you do is based on, look what the son of Amin has done. Oh, what a wonderful the son of Amin has done.
I've had so much of that. But I tell them, you know what? I've had all my life to go through that. And enough's enough. I've gone through it. I've learned to move on, learned to be just who I am. It won't help me. It won't take me anywhere. But it will make me a much better person.
How can I come out of the shadow of my father? I love him as a parent. I cherish his love for me. I am sorry that power corrupted us. You could want whatever you wanted. You could get whatever you want. You can fly whatever you want.
What would life have been if this hadn't happened? If this, what would it have been? Where would I be right now? What would it,
listen,
you put all the equations together and say, I wouldn't change a thing. Who am I to say that, oh, I would have, let me go back. I wish I could go back in time and change and become first son. Why? Huh? Now, let's say they were talking about all of this and then it had happened. Let's say my dad did become president or what, something happened, a coup or whatever, right? Where would I be now? I'd probably be a spoiled brat somewhere, probably even dead. I don't think I would have gone and struggled in the States, then met Bess and had my children, Pam and all. How? Yeah, things changed totally around, 180 degrees for us. From have it all to almost nothing. To see how it felt like to struggle. Things that we had absolutely no idea. Oh, I want a motorbike. Oh, Mom, yeah, I want a motorbike. Okay, fine. Go to Nairobi, buy yourself a motocross bike. Scrambler did that. Anything I wanted.
Omutumu omulala kuba abatava beta mu Uganda sibabalikika bosi bosi bangi kyekigema nibabataho omuntu omulala ati amini seti nibeta yade bakana basoma baita kwita kage siangaho husitopinga baba uwoniyo nobura baba wona nasinganyo kumungama gesi kuba bahatuhisa batu be Mombasa ngena ngalumati Kala ngandi namungulira na angandi yeye yabangabanga hutu nali kongale.
So I don't have any personal grudges towards Amin and his family. I actually see it as a good thing, the reconciliation. It's sad my father passed away. So many things changed. We went through so much, but I can't blame it on Amin or on his children.
Hatali havalaba bana goya gavi. Hanusiveta muze yuyo. Kale na abangwe miahanga hani jija 40. Ebisera nibyolire. Ne sebuli jondo melera batu. Ti amini sina munyigiye nyo kuba niba heno huita wa mwange. Ye gali mpali ya menti. Banu batu samu mwange gani gahafwa. abatu bangi nyoni bali mukulomati
When my mother arrived, finally, when she was allowed to cross the border, she got home and the body had already been brought back, delivered. But with the strict instructions that a casket shouldn't be opened, it should be buried immediately. So one of my uncles said, you know what, we can't do this because we don't know who's in that casket. His children aren't here, they're in Kenya. His wife, widow now, is in Kenya. The mother, my grandmother, was in Kampala at my uncle's house, Dr. Titi. So no one's here. How can we just go ahead? We can't do that. It's un-African. We can't do that. So then the soldiers decide, they listen to reason, and they said, okay, we'll wait and see what else we can do. Let's just hold on for a day or two and wait. But you can go ahead and open the casket. What they saw was practically indescribable. We didn't witness it, we didn't see it. But my mother, well, she came later after they'd washed the body. But they said, well, when they opened it, he wasn't in his suit that he usually used to wear. It was just a shirt, but it was caked in blood. The arms were crossed over his chest. And they were broken, and the face showed trauma, a lot of beating and scratches. There were 33 bullet holes, 3 knife marks around the neck, broken bones. I'm not sure which one, I can't remember, the years have gone, my memory slips me. And one of the bones was actually, had actually torn through the flesh, so it was sticking out. And the leg, one of the legs also was broken up completely. The bone was also sticking out. That's the condition that I was told. They waited for 3 days because they said, look, let's wait for the children to come back. The body started to decompose. Understandably so, when you have open wounds like that. So they decided that, you know what, we better bury him. So my mom said, yeah, let's go ahead and bury him. We arrived 1.5 months later is when we came. I'd broken my arm, I remember, on a motorcycle scrambling in Nairobi at the time. One and a half months later is when we arrived. Why would Uncle Amin do this? Why? Amin came home, would run around, lift me up, joke around with that, call me jet fighter and all of that. I just couldn't understand it when I was a kid. It took me a lot of years.
I don't know at an individual level how much of a regret or sorry. I don't know how to say it. How do you say sorry? At the tragic end of this.
Yeah. Jaffa, you know one thing?
I can't even say sorry on behalf of my father.
I know.
But as an individual, a human being says sorry for what you have just said. I don't think anybody has had this. I have never had the pain that I'm hearing.
I see the burden of the cross you're carrying. And let me tell you one thing. Frankly, I feel sorry for you. Because you are really genuine, decent and honest person and a true friend of mine. But what you're going through, I wouldn't want it in 1,000 years. What happened, happened. We can't change the past. No way.
We can only learn from it and move forward. You can't carry a grudge or say, oh yeah, this and that. No. Let God be the judgment, the judge of all that. You have Ugandans, or you have in society people say, like that saying, was it Gandhi? That an eye for an eye will make the whole world blind.
Whoa.
Yeah. Now, what's the point? If you're all blind, who's going to lead the other to the watering hole? He sensed it, that something was going to happen. His last trip to the farm, he called all his cousins. He got up and said, follow me. So they followed him, joking and laughing and so on. And he walked behind the church that he had built. And he picked up a stick and he stuck it in the ground. And he said, when I die, bury me here.
On behalf of my family, the Al Amin family, and also on behalf of my clan, a lot happened. But there's one thing I know, and one thing I've always known, that this family has always been the family that were true friends to my father. The one who taught him possibilities that were there. The one who showed him ways which he could rule better with. He relied 100% on the Obotho Fumbi family. When we were in exile, he used to lament. It is almost like when two friends go apart, or a marriage is, somebody goes through divorce. You remember the love. You remember the happiness. You remember the joy. You remember the sorrow. I was innocent as a child, but I will keep going and asking us to be one. May you accept my apology on behalf of my people, on behalf of my father, on behalf of the issues of power. The acceptance is a humbling experience for me. And I thank my mother. Thank you.
The confession the son has made. You are a merciful father and you forgive. We pray and we understand you have forgiven him. These people loved each other. We saw them, they came here. That whoever asks forgiveness, you forgive. We thank you, Father, because you have forgiven us. Bring us together. Bring us in one. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We honor your presence. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you. To pray for Father and Mother.
Thank you. Yeah.
Welcome back to the family.
Thank you.
There's one other thing that I want to let you know right now. My late father used to, well, when he used to come here and also spend the night here, he on one occasion he came and he laid the foundation stone of this private chapel of ours. During the 1979 war, when Kampala had fallen, it was deemed advisable to plaster off that particular foundation stone that had your father's name, the one that he laid for this church. My mother and the whole family members have said it's now time that, since this ceremony has happened, that we will remove the tiles that cover that. So finally, since 1979 up to now, it's been covered. It can finally be out for the whole world to read it.
My mother accepted.
Accepted very well, without any hesitation. Remember when I mentioned it? Without any hesitation. It was really quite astonishing.
Go ahead.
Just break it.
No way, no symbolic.
Yeah, are you ready? His Excellency General Idi Amin Dada, President of the Republic of Uganda, and Mrs. Esther Manjeri Alowo Ofumbi, widow of the late Semo K. Ofumbi. That's exactly what it says.
We thank you very much for your coming. But sir, in our culture, we have some thing to be done and we clear off any problems completely. We need you to bring here a bull for slaughtering, mm-hmm. one heifer of a cow, mm-hmm. for keeping the at the home, mm-hmm. one male sheep, mm-hmm. a he goat, three cocks. Mm-hmm. You are the one to bring these things mm-hmm. nations above. Mm-hmm. And whenever you come, feel at home. We are ready to receive you. God is of us giving for God and our family.
And the country.
Not the country.
Thank you, Mzee.
Yeah.
Thank you. This is exactly how Kakwas do it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Give this sheep as the atonement. This one is the symbol of cleansing. May the two families come together and stay together and work together and help together and have the same love that they used to have in the past. On this day, this one will prove to us that we are one again. Me and Godfrey, both of Fumbi.
Maundo paliwa 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 ya chokado. Chakichewa wedi ang sira malo. Maundo paliwa.